Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Today's opening acclamation reminds me of the story of an Easter day in Abilene many years ago. The wise and trusted interim rector, Don Hungerford, stood in the pulpit and proclaimed this Easter acclamation, you know, Hallelujah, Christ is risen, and then he sat down. And that was the sermon. And of course, it is the sermon. And I have to say, that event, that story has been told for a couple of decades now in Abilene. One good friend of ours remembers that he had bent over to tie his daughter's shoelaces during this opening acclamation. And when he sat back up in the pew and realized that the sermon was over, he thought that he had had an out-of-body experience. So today we gather to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, to celebrate that by God's grace we are raised with Jesus, to celebrate that by the power of God's love we are raised from death to new life. And as the Gospels tell the story of the event at the empty tomb on the third day, it is apparent that this is an experience which transcends time and space. It is not so much an out-of-body experience as it is the transformation to a new body, but quite obviously, this is something beyond our normal linear expectations. Perhaps you have noticed that none of the four Gospels tell this story exactly the same way. I would suggest that the differences in the story do not call into question the credibility of the witnesses, as if the witnesses to an event cannot get their story straight. It's not that. Rather, the four different accounts of the story reveal that this is a mystical event, a religious experience, not easily described or explained in words. It's beyond words in many ways. So today I want to look at the three accounts of Peter's role in the story. Peter is the only official disciple, the only one of the 12 mentioned by name in the resurrection stories. Mary Magdalene is named in all four, Peter in three. According to John's gospel, upon hearing that the body of Jesus is missing, Peter races to the tomb, loses the foot race to another, but enters the tomb first. The tomb is empty. He and the other disciple, presumably John, they return to their homes, leaving behind the weeping Mary Magdalene. We can only imagine that Peter and John are too caught up in their own emotions, their own grief, to offer any kind of pastoral care or support to the visibly distressed Mary. In Luke's gospel, Peter runs to the tomb, but for a different reason. He is told by the women that they have been to the empty tomb and they encountered angels who announced that Jesus is risen. Peter runs to the tomb to see it for himself as if it's too good to be true. And in Mark's gospel, the women enter the tomb and the angel says, "He has been raised. But go, tell the disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee." Peter is one of the disciples, of course, yet the angel is specific. Tell Peter. It's as if the angel is saying, especially don't forget Peter. Be sure to tell Peter. And I wonder why Peter is the one disciple mentioned in three out of four Gospels. Why Peter runs to the tomb, why Peter must be told specifically, why Peter must not be overlooked, and I suspect it's something more than his being in the Lord's inner circle, and more than being the extroverted, natural-born leader among the disciples, and more than being the rock. Of course, like all the disciples, he's dealing with loss, the loss of a friend, the loss of the leader, the teacher, the mentor, the loss of a cause to which he had given his life, But I wonder if most of all, Peter is suffering with extreme guilt and shame. For Peter saw himself as strong and self-confident. Peter was one of the first to throw down his nets when the Lord said, "Follow me." Peter was the first to get it right when Jesus questioned the 12, "And who do you say that I am?" Peter blurted out the answer, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." When Jesus reveals to the 12 that he must suffer and be killed and on the third day be raised, it's Peter who boldly steps up and declares, "God forbid, this shall never happen to you." It's Peter who says to Jesus, "You shall never wash my feet." Peter sees himself as strong and loyal and faithful. So when in the face of persecution, Peter vehemently denies that he knows Jesus of Nazareth at all, and then remembers the Lord's prediction, as the cock crows, he breaks down and weeps, shattered and deeply ashamed. So the angel gets specific with the women at the tomb. "Tell Peter, Jesus has been raised. You will find him in Galilee." Clearly, Peter receives the message. In fact, Peter writes a letter describing his experience of the risen Lord. And the church actually includes his letter in the New Testament. It's his testimony. Peter writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." Now, Peter writes this letter to Christians under persecution, and he writes it with personal and direct knowledge of God's grace. He writes it as a failure who experienced firsthand God's mercy. He writes as one who has experienced undeserved forgiveness and new life. And his experience takes on a ripple effect as his personal story, his testimony of guilt and shame and failure, transformed to new life. That testimony is shared with 20 centuries of Christians. Perhaps you have seen the stage production or the movie Les Miserables. Maybe some of you have tackled the book. It's a story set in 19th century France, a time and place of destitution and degradation. The people are poor and powerless. Revolution lies on the horizon. And as the story goes, there lived a man whose name was Jean Valjean. He stole some bread to save his sister's son. For 19 winters served his time, in sweat he worked away his crime. After 19 years, Jean Valjean is released on parole, starving, exhausted, grimy, and angry. Seen as a thief, and not even allowed to sleep in a stable, he is offered food and shelter by the local bishop. The bishop, representing the church at her best, invites the ex-convict into his quarters, sets food in front of the starving man, who gobbles it down while the bishop prays, "Bless our honored guest." Later in the night, Valjean steals silver vessels from the bishop and makes a run for it, only to be caught by the constables. He is then returned to the bishop with the evidence at hand. The bishop approaches Valjean with two more silver candlesticks in his hands and says, "But my friend, you left so early. Surely something slipped your mind. You forgot I gave these also. Would you leave the best behind?" The bishop dismisses the constables and turns to Valjean and says, "And remember this, my brother, seeing this some high plan, you must use this precious silver to become an honest man. By the witness of the martyrs, by the passion and the blood, God has raised you out of darkness. I have bought your soul for God." deeply moved by the bishop's love and grace and generosity, Valjean declares, another story must begin. And he spends the rest of his life sharing that same unconditional love and radical grace with others. New life for Valjean is more than a new life of personal peace and the knowledge that he is forgiven or saved. It has a ripple effect. The same love and grace is offered to others, including a young woman forced into prostitution, the woman's daughter whom he adopts, the police inspector who is tracking him for breaking parole, a man who is falsely accused, a man who is trapped under a runaway cart, a young revolutionary who loves Valjean's adopted daughter. All of these people experience the compassion and grace of Jean Valjean. The story's dramatic ending occurs in the chapel of a convent where Valjean is dying. The membrane between this world and the world to come is thin in that chapel of that convent. Angels and archangels and all the company of heaven are present. All who have been raised by God's grace to a new life through their respective encounters with Jean Valjean, all those gathered are there. The gathering includes those on both sides of this thin membrane between this world and the world to come. And they are singing. Do you hear the people singing? Lost in the valley of the night. It is the music of the people who are climbing to the light. For the wretched of the earth, there is a flame that never dies. Even the darkest night will end, and the sun will rise. As we gather on Easter Day around this altar, we join with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, with apostles, prophets, and martyrs, with Sunday school teachers and altar guild members and acolytes, with family, friends, and mentors, with the great cloud of witnesses, all part of God's ripple effect of love, mercy, grace, forgiveness, the church at her best. Do you hear the people singing? Alleluia. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.